Professor Bengali, and ask you. I recall very recently the governor of Edo State, Adams Oshiomhole, said that he's not going to make life comfortable for criminals in this state. And he's ready and happy to sign death warrants if anybody is put on the death warrant, is got death penalty on their table. Yeah, he's happy to sign it. Should we be considering what China is doing? If you're found corrupt, there's a possibility of being sentenced to death.
You see, corruption does exact costs, and the costs are quite steep and brutal on everybody. You know, it's the fact that we've got steep maternal mortality is down to corruption. The fact that we've got an education system that's not working, kids that cannot go to school, a lot of it is down to corruption. The
planes falling out of the sky.
Absolutely, planes falling out of the sky. A lot of and roads that are death traps for Nigerians, all of that is corruption, or the result of corruption. Now, the question for me there is not the punishment, it is whether or not the people are caught. You see, you can inscribe any punishment you want, but if you don't catch the folks who do it, you will never have the opportunity to punish them.
Mm-hmm.
And so for me, I think the real challenge is the deterrent value of being able to, one, prevent these kinds of conduct, and two, to arrest and bring to account the people that do it. Even if you sentence them to 1 week in prison, or 2 years in prison, or 5 years in prison, it is better than having capital punishment that never stands the chance of happening.
Mm-hmm.
And I do think that's the way we've got to work it out. We've got to begin to have the administrative procedures have to work. Interdiction, suspension, lustration from political office, and then criminal processes.
Mm-hmm.
Until we begin to do those things, all the punishments in the book are not going to change anything.
But Prof, I have an issue with corruption. I think that the entire Nigerian system is built to make the people corrupt. How do you pay a man 50,000 naira a month and you want him to survive on it? You know he can't. That he is surviving means he's doing other things, and we all know that for a fact. A man retires, he's paid 200 naira a month as his retirement benefit. How is he supposed to exist after that? Because there is no social system that will look after him after he's 55 or 60, he's got to steal more than enough and put away for his old age. The whole system, I think, is guaranteed to make you steal. I'd like your take on that. The whole system has to be overhauled to make people be able to live on what they earn, and there should also be a system to look after them after they have retired.
Unquestionably so. That means we've got to reform pensions, we've got to address a lot of things. But look, both of my parents are teachers. My parents had 10 of us. Every one of us, 10 of us. They're both still alive. They were teachers. They sent every one of us to university on their salaries, right? Something is wrong because my parents earned less than the folks who are working now.
Yeah.
So something is fundamentally wrong. I do understand the points you're making. A lot of it is about take home, that's right. But more fundamentally, we've got to address values. And the values, look, there's not enough money in the Nigerian budget to buy me. I'm a poor man, materially. But we don't appropriate enough money in this country to buy me. And I do think it is important that we've got to have public officers who cannot be bought with all the money in Nigeria's budgets.
Okay. And lots of them are going there to go steal. That's why they want to go into office in the first place.
And I'd like to think that a lot of people don't go into office to steal.
A number are also going there to serve, without a doubt.
Absolutely.
Well, we have to wrap up now because we'll be moving shortly into the retreat session by the Nigeria Governors Forum. But your final word, what would be your message to Nigerians who are watching now and to people in government in terms of our preparation for 2015?
It's a very important year, and it's going to be like determining for the future of our country. All of us must work up. We need to take 2015 very serious. Let's see if it's possible for us to all contribute and participate to make democracy work. It's not just about the politicians. It's about every Nigerian who have to play a role. Whatever it is, we still don't have any other place other than our own country. Indeed. And that Nigeria must be fixed by Nigerians. If we don't do it, we are going to suffer and we are going to lose it. Things are changing, and I'm a little bit encouraged with some of the development that we are witnessing. There seems to be a better heightened anxiety and understanding that this country is in trouble and that people must come together. Let's come together, unify, unity is power. And if we come together, then possibility do exist that we may begin to do what is right. Let's have a free and fair elections. Let the law enforcement, let those who are in charge of our own affairs, for the sake of the poor, the ordinary Nigeria, please let them pity us. Let them give us a free and fair election so that we will see a new Nigeria.
Okay, Prof, we cannot go without mentioning the fact that NHRC has been involved in investigating the case in Enugu State, the wife of Governor Chime. What is it? Can we use that this final word from you as an opportunity for Nigerians to know
what the position is
and what is her situation from what you know?
I chair the council in a quasi-judicial capacity. And that case is due to be considered by us next month. And I think it will be proper to leave it at that.
Okay.
And at the right time, hopefully we'll commit to do the right thing by the law and by the fact.
And that means you will reveal all, or you will sort of like sweep someone under the carpet?
I can guarantee that we're not in the business at the National Human Rights Commission of sweeping anything under the carpet.
So all
the only thing we guarantee is we do right by the law and by the facts. Quite clearly, some matters may fall within a realm that we are obliged to keep confidential if, for instance, they are precluded by law. But to the extent that the law allows, we'll do right by the law and by the facts.
All right. Thank you very much. It's been a great pleasure having with us this morning. And this time around, I'll start with Ma Lamnuhu Ribadu, former chairman of EFCC and erstwhile candidate of the ACN as presidential candidate. Thank you very much for being with us this morning.
I'm Professor Chidi Odinkalu. Great to have you here, chairman of NHRC. Thanks for coming.
Thanks for a great deal. Well, have a wonderful weekend.